아리랑 스페셜.
I'm currently listening to American folk singer Bob Dylan, who also happens to be the winner of the 2016 Nobel Prize in Literature. Sometimes in life, one little unexpected incident can change history and shake us to our core. The year 2016 was a very eventful year in terms of politics, diplomacy, economy, and culture. So together with you today, we will go over some of the major events that shook the world in 2016. Now today I am accompanied by our panelists here. Thank you very much for joining me. And before we start, can you please introduce yourselves to our viewers?
Well, hello, I am Cho Ju-yeon, and I'm the current host of Arirang TV's Global Business Report. I'm also working as a consecutive conference interpreter, and it's great to be here, and thanks for having me.
All right, thank you.
Hello, I'm Shin Se-min. I'm currently a reporter at Arirang TV, and now I cover the economic front, including the Bank of Korea and the Finance Ministry. I'm happy to be here with you all.
All right, welcome to the show.
Hello, great to be here. I'm currently the host of Good Morning Seoul, a morning news show on Arirang Radio, and I also worked as a reporter and anchor at Arirang TV for about 6 years before joining the radio.
All right, sounds good. And?
Hi, I'm Carlos Garrito. I'm currently working for the Embassy of Brazil here in Seoul, and I've also been on Korean TV for almost 2 years now. It's really a pleasure to be here. Thanks for having me here today.
All right, well, it's a great pleasure to have all of you here, last day of 2016. Now, we'll be talking about various issues that shook the world in 2016. Maybe I can ask you, before we start, what was maybe the most or your most memorable moment or event of 2016?
Well, I think I don't have any memorable things that happened in my personal life, but career-wise, I think joining the radio was a big event for me this year because it was a totally new field for me.
All right. What about you, Carlos?
For me, it was covering the Rio Olympics for a Korean newspaper. It was really a very interesting experience for me. So it was in my hometown, but talking to a Korean audience, writing in Korean, and also helping promote 2018 Winter Olympics in Pyeongchang to the Brazilian audience as well. So it's really an amazing experience for me.
All right. What about you, Sammy?
Tagging on what Carlos just said, being a reporter gives you a lot of room to have a lot of events that sticks to your mind. Mm-hmm. Looking back from politics to economy, I was also able to cover Rio Olympics on the ground. That was a privilege as a reporter, so that's one of the most important and memorable things that sticks to my mind.
I was watching the games at home. Yeah. What about you, Chiyeon, 2016?
Well, for me, I think that 2016 was a great year as well. And I played hard, I worked hard, and I ate hard as well. But generally speaking, I think that it was a year that was unexpected on a lot of the fronts, politically, economically, as we can see all over the world and here in Korea as well.
All right, well, it sounds like 2016 was a very special year for all of you. So let's not waste any time. Let's check out the first topic. All right, so the fourth industrial revolution. I think many people have been talking about this earlier this year. Ju-yeon, you probably talked about this on your program. Right?
Yes, I think I've said Fourth Industrial Revolution so many times I can memorize it. But if you look back at the history, I think the First Industrial Revolution used steam power to mechanize production. And then it moved on to the Second Industrial Revolution, which uses electric power to actually enable mass production. And then you move on to the Third Industrial Revolution, which actually uses a combination of electronics robotics and information technology to automate production. And now you come to the fourth industrial revolution, which we talk about so many times. And it's actually a culmination of all these different technologies and blurring the lines between physical, digital, and biological. And it was also mentioned at the World Economic Forum.
Yeah, so it's definitely a big revolution for all of us, and it's shaping the world, changing the world very, very quickly.
Definitely.
Which technologies are you most interested in?
Well, I've been learning about all of this, and I think that VR and AR is absolutely impressive, and the speed of technology is really fast. And I would definitely want to put myself in one of those automated cars one day, too.
Yeah, I would love to have a self-driving car.
Yes.
And I would be able to call my friends, do some work while I relax in my car on the way to work. It's good for soul in the traffic, you know?
Yes.
What about artificial intelligence?
Artificial intelligence, yeah. Yes, that's one of the topping points that also was discussed during the this year's World Economic Forum held in Davos, Switzerland. And also there, Arirang was one of the major broadcasters to moderate a session called The State of Artificial Intelligence. Mm-hmm. There, the Arirang TV also shouldered other broadcasters like the UK's BBC, NHK, and CNN in moderating the sessions.
I see. What about you, Carlos? Are you a tech guy?
I wouldn't say I'm a tech guy, but I like the topic, and I'm always trying to read a little bit about it. I'm really excited about IoT, Internet of Things.
Okay.
So I'm really looking forward to see more IoT appliances, gadgets that can actually make our lives easier and that can, mm-hmm. we can save more time. I wish we had some technology that would clean my house and get everything ready before I get home so I don't have to really worry about that.
More convenience.
Of course.
Right? Robots, yeah, robots also maybe cleaning our homes, doing things for us. And they're becoming very intelligent these days. Artificial intelligence, as we said. Earlier in the year, we also had AlphaGo.
Oh, yeah.
You remember that? AlphaGo, that was a big thing here in Korea. And we humans, we lost. And this computer software basically beat one of the top Go players here in Korea. All right, so do you guys remember this intense battle between Korean player Lee Sedol and AlphaGo?
Yes.
I was actually watching some of the games. I'm like, so who's gonna win? I'm not very, very familiar with this game actually, but it was pretty intense and it was all over the news too. And I guess we humans only won once.
Lee Sedol said that AlphaGo was unlike any of his human opponents he faced in the past because, you know, these computer systems, they're psychologically unfazed and they can stay focused. You know how long Go matches last? They last for like several hours. And the fourth match in which Lee Sedol won, it lasted for 5 hours. So staying focused is very important in winning these matches. And that's the strength of these computer systems.
They don't have any ups and downs
yes.
like us, right?
They don't get swayed.
That's one of the ways that your opponents could see what your opponent's next move could be down the line, because seeing their emotions and reactions after I make a move is one of the ways that you could strategically have it played on the game, but this time you weren't able to do anything. Yeah. You weren't able to see any of the emotions coming out of the computer itself, so I guess it was an unfair game in that sense for Isidore.
What I got out of this is that, I mean, we are making computers and robots that become smarter and smarter every single year. So my question is, are they going to take our jobs?
I mean, that's one of the talking points during the World Economic Forum early this year. A lot of the participants there were discussing what would happen should computers start dominating some of the jobs, including starting with white collar jobs, including journalists. And
Uh-oh.
What would
Uh-oh.
Happen?
We might not be
exactly,
here.
That's
next
an alarming call. Jobs too.
And what were to happen, and how should we be able to prepare for such incident?
But at the same time that many professions disappear, we also have new professions coming.
That's right, new jobs.
Yeah, new jobs, new activities, new businesses, new things are happening. So if we think in a positive way, there's plenty to benefit from this new revolution.
Especially for Korea, since Korea is, you know, one of the major IT powerhouses, ICT powers.
Yeah, Korea is really on the edge of technology in general, and especially when you talk about the next industrial revolution, the fourth industrial revolution, we definitely see many Korean businesses and many Korean born technologies spreading all over the world.
Yeah. Well, I'm also looking forward to all this progress, all these new innovations in terms of AI, artificial intelligence. And we'll be on the lookout. Next year also is going to be fascinating, I think, in that sense. Now, let's take a look at another interesting topic together. Right, so Pokemon. Now we're going to be talking about this interesting game. I'm saying interesting. I actually don't know if it's interesting. I haven't played this game myself, but it was all over the news, and people were going crazy, running in the streets, falling down, and things like that. So Pokemon, have any of you played this game?
Yes.
Not yet.
I have.
Oh, you have. Can you tell us about your experience?
I wasn't able to play it in Korea because there were certain areas where you were only allowed to play it, but while I was traveling overseas, I played it at the airports from gate to gate, running around, trying to see if there's any Pokemon on the loose. It's actually a game that brings a lot of people from a lot of generations, because that's the game that was first released years ago, and I think it brings about some of the memories back for a lot of smartphone users nowadays, inviting them to have a match on their own, on their mobile devices, so yeah.
Have you tried this game, Carlos?
Well, I haven't tried it, but many friends have.
Okay.
And among my friends, actually this was all over the news, we had many incidents and accidents because of Pokemon. People got so...
They got so absorbed
the game. They couldn't drive anymore. Yes. While they were driving, they saw a Pikachu and they had to stop to get the Pikachu. Yeah. And I heard that there was even a bus driver in Japan that he was caught playing Pokemon while he was driving. So imagine all the risks involved by being so absorbed in the Pokemon game.
Augmented reality, so that's what it's about. Virtual reality is also pretty common these days. VR, as they call it, with those interesting goggles, right? So you see people doing funny things and you don't know what they are seeing, but they are in their own world. Maybe we can talk a little bit about virtual reality as well. Yeah?
Well, I've personally tried a lot of those goggles, and I think that it was quite impressive. I mean, there is this thing called the continuum of reality, where you have physical reality, and you have augmented, you have mixed reality, and at the other end, you have virtual reality. But so as you progress along the line, you have your physical space, a mixture of them, and then completely into a new space.
Yeah.
But I guess the technology is still developing, and we do have a long ways to go. But these goggles are amazing. You should really try them because, you know, I've had one of those like horror movie experiences where you're entering into this house and then you hear something in your right ear and you start to turn around, but you're kind of afraid to because something does, you know, poke its head out. And so it's very real. It does have its side effects like a bit of nausea and you're off balance, but I think that, you know, that will be solved as technology evolves.
So yeah, it's definitely an interesting, full of potential technology that's going to grow even more. Maybe for people who like traveling, but who can't, or who want to escape maybe their daily lives at work, they can wear goggles and I don't know, take a little trip somewhere.
Yeah. You can climb the Himalayas.
Sure.
You know, I'm going to climb the Himalayas. I'll be right back.
Not just for entertainment purposes. They also use it for medical purposes because, like post-traumatic stress disorder, a lot of the medical groups are actually using VR to attend to their patients as well.
Training purposes too.
Right. Imagine for some dangerous jobs, for example, virtual reality could be very useful to train, to have our employees, our workers to perform tasks that otherwise they wouldn't have the same opportunities to train. So I think business can really take a very good advantage out of it.
So we'll continue to, of course, follow up on these trends, IT-related issues with all of you. And I'm also looking forward to next year. It's going to be fascinating. Hope we'll have even better quality VR, virtual reality, maybe other games like Pokemon Go, which will drive maybe the crowds crazy, hopefully in a safe way,
yes,
with no accidents. But yeah, it's fascinating. Now, we just talked about the fourth industrial revolution and IT innovations, new technologies. This time we're going to talk about another revolution, but in Europe and in politics. And I'm talking about Brexit. The UK back in June this year voted to leave the European Union. And that was very shocking. Shocking for me, maybe for you and the rest of the world as well. So what exactly happened?
Well, it was a referendum that was held on June 23rd to decide whether the UK should leave or remain in the European Union, and they decided to leave. And first of all, I would like to...
Why? Why? I don't understand why.
We'll get to the why. Yeah. But first of all, I would like to explain what the European Union is. It's an economic and political partnership involving 28 European countries.
Yes.
And it's the single biggest market in the world, and it accounts for 23% of the global GDP, and it uses its own currency, the euro. 19 member states, countries use that currency. So if there's any impact on the European Union, this economic bloc, then it will definitely have an impact on the global economy as well.
Yeah. And it did. Mm. I mean,
it was seen in, I mean, global financial market rattled for a while, and then a lot of capital outflows seen in developing nations, and our currency differences were also spotted around the world, including not to mention the UK.
But fortunately, the UK weathered the initial shock of Brexit quite well, and the stock prices, they rebounded. The FTSE 100 and the broader FTSE 250, they're actually trading higher than before the referendum.
Really?
But
the pound is pretty weak.
The value of the pound is near a 30-year low, and then UK, it's they lost their top AAA credit rating. So the long-term effects of Brexit, it has to be seen.
But I think what happened was that it's one of the 10 EU member states that contribute the most to the EU budget. But compared to what it's paying, it wasn't getting enough out of it. So I think that a lot of people were saying no to that. And of course, there were some recurring issues because of that: border control, immigration. A lot of the refugee crisis had a lot to do with it. And lastly, terrorism was another big issue. Mm-hmm.
Right, but I think it has a ripple effect all in all. It started with Grexit, if you remember, like Greece exiting the EU. And like Chuyun mentioned, there are only a number of countries that are responsible, economically responsible, for the burden that the EU is putting up. And I think it triggered a big gunpoint from the Grexit, when Greece was literally on huge debt, giving a lot of responsibility on Germany and Britain too. So I think that was one of the starting point to begin with, but with the immigration statuses and all the others piling up on top of it, caused this tight referendum that we saw. Yeah.
So one of the main keywords here is protectionism. So this is just one example with Brexit. Of course, we'll be talking about the US and, you know, President-elect Donald Trump as well. It's not just black or white. It's hard to draw the line. However, in politics, you have to give the power to one party or one leader, and that's not always easy. There is one thing that connects us to the UK, us tourists, but also us working for Arirang. Maybe Arirang TV, right? People can watch Arirang TV in the UK as well.
Right. So until now, viewers in the UK had to buy their own antennas and receivers to watch our channel. But from now on, all they need to do is just turn on the TV. Arirang provides its services across 188 countries around the world. And this, of course, includes the US. Arirang TV services are being provided in many cities, for example, through a global satellite platform, DirecTV, and the UN's in-house network in New York.
Yeah, so there you go. I mean, Arirang is international. It is also expanding, and hopefully more and more households all over the world will be able to enjoy our programs and learn more about Korea. Now, we talked about protectionism, and this not only affects the UK, it also affects America. And as we all know, President-elect Donald Trump will be the next president. And he also mentioned during his campaign that he would implement very strict protectionist measures. And this is pretty shocking for some of us.
Right. Trump's victory was one of the biggest upsets in modern political history. And even until Election Day, it was a near even race, you might remember. But experts are saying that Trump's victory was led by a largely overlooked coalition of blue-collar white and working-class voters, especially in the rural areas.
I think that Trump was embroiled in a lot of controversial issues. And, you know, some of the words that he said during the campaign, I think, were appalling. And it was very surprising to see people actually give him the vote after all of that. But I think what happened is people tended to go towards a lesser evil of the two. And they wanted someone who could really make America be that great economy once again.
He wants to put America first, and he won the election. I mean, it's shocking, but there is nothing we can do about it. What did you have to say about this whole issue?
America first policy?
Yeah.
Well,
American elections.
You know, Trump did pledge that he will build the wall across the Mexican border and deport 11 million illegal immigrants and scrap or renegotiate all the trade deals he has with other countries, including with Korea. So we'll have to see how his campaign rhetoric actually translates into his policies, because we don't know much. There aren't many details out about his policies, especially foreign policy. Economic policies are the ones that we are most interested in as a foreign country.
Right, but like you said, the CORUS FTA, since that mention of Trump during his campaign trail, a lot of local exporters here in Korea were on edge because they were gearing up for a potential impact if it were, because should the incoming Trump administration were to renegotiate the existing FTA deal, that would mean a lot to export-reliant Korean economy. So, but at the same time, a lot of local authorities here in Korea aren't that rosy in terms of having that pact revised, because renegotiation of the FTA deal would also mean a huge dent in Korea-U.S. alliance and its relations. So he's going to be cautious when carrying out such pledges that he said during campaign trail. So like you said, we can just only wait and see how that pans out.
Yeah. I guess many Americans maybe were fed up with the current system.
The establishment.
Right.
The party.
Yes. Maybe corruption as well. Or maybe less in America. Here in Korea, we had some issues regarding corruption. And I'm saying this very nicely. But yes, there is even a law now, an anti-corruption law that was voted. And that is enforced at the moment, right? Maybe we can talk about that as well. Here in Korea, we also have our own specific problems in politics. Yes.
Right. So this anti-graft law is also dubbed as the Kim Yong-nan law. And simply put, you just have to remember the 3-5-10 rule. It's the upper limit set for meals, gifts, and cash gifts. So 30,000 won is the upper limit for meals, okay. 50,000 won is the upper limit for gifts, and 100,000 won is the upper limit for cash gifts or cash payments, because it's a tradition, a culture in Korea to give cash gifts to someone that's having a special personal occasion like weddings mm-hmm. or funerals. So it's basically to prohibit unlawful requests or gifts that they give in return for some kind of a favor.
Yeah, so how is this affecting the Korean economy? I heard that many restaurants were struggling because of this.
Right, restaurant businesses are the hardest hit by this new law. Their sales dropped by more than 30% since this new law took effect. And this was one of the concerns of the government because they were worried that this new law will get in the way of their push to boost the economy, and especially when it comes to domestic consumption, because domestic consumption is one of the two main pillars that led Korea's economic growth mm-hmm. along with exports. So there are speculation now that the next administration might be revising this law,
yeah.
but we never know.
So this is, I mean, just one aspect of Korean politics. With this law, people really fed up with corruption and, you know, conglomerates and the government, and many people on the streets. We've seen millions of people on the streets protesting late at night in the cold with candles. I think you live in that area, Carlos.
Yes, so the embassy of Brazil is very close to Gwanghwamun, actually very close to Chongwadae.
Uh-huh.
And I happen to live in this
the
Blue House, sorry. I live and work very close to the Blue House.
Okay.
So I was in the middle of the protests.
Middle of history.
Yeah, I was seeing history happen from my window. It was really an honor for me. I was impressed by how people were so organized, how peaceful the protests were, and how we could see children from 8 until like grandmas and grandpas in their 80s, like really going on the streets, like making an effort to make Korea better.
I mean, you were there many times.
Yes, of course. I've actually was on ground for 4 straight weekends on Saturdays. And as you said, it's very peacefully carried out. I mean, it's hard to call it a demonstration or protest if you see vendors out on streets selling snacks, because that's not what you see on protest scenes. But a lot of the protesters there were peacefully carrying out, and people call it a peaceful demonstration. But by speaking to some of the protesters there, the reason that they don't want to cause or they stay away from causing any incidents is because they don't want their voices and their message be tainted by some of the incidents if yes. it were to happen. So they're being very cautious of what they're carrying out every weekend. And it's not just a number that we're, thousands and millions.
We
collect and report on the different numbers of people who were on street. But the number doesn't seem to matter when you get there, because it's just a group action that's taking place in a peaceful manner with no accidents. So
one thing I want to note here is that the courts allowed these protesters to come nearer and nearer to the presidential office of mm-hmm. Chongwadae, which was quite unprecedented. And on the 6th protest, I believe that was on December 3rd, protesters were allowed within 100 meters of Chongwadae. That is the first time they allowed that in Korean history. So that was impressive, and so, that was how peaceful they were.
Yeah, so that's during the last, I think early December, the protest that we had on early December, I was finally allowed to go to my office on a Saturday. Because before I couldn't. I will go to them, the policeman, no, you can't come, but I live here, no. But I work here, no, you can't come. And then finally, with all those, they saw that it was very peaceful, very organized, mm-hmm. so they finally allowed it. For me, it was very practical, also in a personal way.
They get together with good minds and good will. I mean, candles in winter times with big jackets, all crowded in one place. I smelled a lot of burnt clothes passing by, no joke. And I've seen a couple people with a little bit of a burn marks, but they're not angry at each other. They know, I mean, it's one of the accidents that could easily be caused at scenes like that, but either the one who caused the burnt mark or the ones wearing that jacket weren't very bitter. They were very understanding,
because
even in that situation.
Because they're there for a bigger
cause. Yes. Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, this bigger cause is not only maybe the establishment, that's definitely part of it, with corruption and political issues. I think the economy has a big role also in this. And I mean, on the global scene, economies are not doing so great these days. And if we go back to, we talked about America, I mean, we can slightly go back to maybe the US and talk about economy as well. I mean, President-elect Donald Trump, he promised a lot of things. Also, for the economy, do you really think there is going to be any major breakthroughs in 2017 or after he enters the White House?
Well, I mean, he also talked about having consumers boycott Apple. And he was saying how Apple should be made within the US. And he wanted to boycott Apple and have a lot of the consumers do that because Apple refused when the FBI wanted to probe into a terrorist's iPhone. They wouldn't let him or let the government go into that that data. But, you know, talking about boycotting the biggest company there is, maybe in terms of IT, I think is very different from having a voice in politics. Because, you know, if you want to revive the economy, I think Apple is probably one of the companies that you really have to support in terms of policies.
Yeah, he didn't make friends during his election campaign. I mean, everyone was against him. IT companies, of course. He's, I guess, trying to find his way and trying to make friends again now, since he's going to be the next president. He's also working with other countries. I mean, his politics, you talked about foreign affairs, his relationship with Russia, so it's pro-Russian, maybe, stance and anti-China. Yeah, diplomacy, I don't know.
Let's first look at Trump's stance towards Russia. If we look at his latest cabinet pick, it was ExxonMobil CEO Rex Tillerson. And he's not he was appointed as the Secretary of State, but he's not an experienced diplomat. But he has very close ties with Russia and Russian President Vladimir Putin. So, analysts see this as Trump wanting some warmer relations with Russia or resetting relations with Russia. So he's going towards Russia in many aspects, I believe, through this appointment.
I mean, he recently had many problems with China, right?
Yes. I think that he does have to sort out things with China. If I were in his role, I think that I would want my enemies close to me, even though I do see them as enemies. But if you want to advance in the world, coming back to reviving the economy once again, I think partnering with a country like China would be a good thing for the US. But I mean, whatever he's thinking, I'm not sure, I'm not in his mind. But you know, he really has to set another direction for China. That's my personal opinion.
I mean, Russia, China, Japan are all, you know, our neighbors here in Korea, or for us in Korea. So what kind of role do you think Korea can play within this flow of foreign diplomacy?
With the U.S., the incoming administration making a new friend in Russia, that could work as a leverage if you think about it, because one of the points that, one of the reasons that China and Russia play a big role in containing North Korea is because they're close allies there together, three of them. So by leveraging it with Russia and maybe, not sure about China, because at this point, Trump seems to have a sour relations at this point, but in the longer run, having your enemies close by isn't a bad idea.
So. And that's why, I mean, Korea is keeping a close eye on the US and their relationship with Russia and China, because Russia and China have been in the past on maybe North Korea's side. I don't want to be too blunt or diplomatically incorrect, but they have backed North Korea. China has helped North Korea.
I guess that's because China and Russia are all traditional allies of North Korea. But if we take a look at what kind of foreign policy the incoming Trump administration will come up, I talked to an expert in my show, and he believes that the U.S. will not accept a nuclear North Korea, that's for sure. But the difference between the current Obama administration and probably the incoming Trump administration is that Trump will be more open to dialogue with North Korea because Trump doesn't have any track record in the area of national security or foreign affairs. So he would want to score big on North Korea, want to prove himself that he can do diplomacy and deal with these foreign affairs.
Through negotiations, right?
I can picture the two together.
Yeah, because Trump said that he's willing to have hamburger during their talks, during his talks with Kim Jong-un. So I think many experts believe that Trump will give a dialogue a chance with North Korea.
Now, regarding North Korea, the United Nations Security Council unanimously imposed tough sanctions or tougher sanctions on North Korea this year as it continued its nuclear activities. So North Korea conducted its fourth nuclear detonation earlier this year in January, and then several months later in September, they carried out their fifth nuclear test. So the world is imposing more and more sanctions on North Korea, but my question is that really going to help us?
Well, first of all, I think that getting China on our side and trying to persuade China to persuade North Korea is probably our best bet yet, because if you look back in history, North Korea only listens to a handful of countries, and the biggest one there is probably China. And you have to get China on board with these kind of sanctions, not providing leeway for North Korea within those sanctions, but really putting their foot down and saying no is no. And only when that happens, I think, you know, North Korea will recognize that they have nowhere else to go.
Mm-hmm. And the new UN resolution that was adopted following the fifth nuclear test was aimed at closing the loopholes. As you mentioned, China loosely interpreted the previous resolution, and they allowed North Korean coal imports under the exception clause called exports for livelihood purposes.
Okay.
So the new resolution 2321 is aimed at really closing these loopholes and further squeezing North Korea of its coal export revenue. And China has to do their part. As you said, China's role is critical in making these sanctions effective. And China has actually put a temporary ban on North Korean imports until the end of this year as part of the new sanctions. But we'll have to see how China cooperates in making these sanctions effective and powerful.
Yeah, now North Korea's nuclear program is a serious threat. I mean, for us here in South Korea, for Asia in general, for the world, and maybe for Carlos as well. Since he's from Brazil, I think your parents were very worried when you told them, okay, I'm moving to South Korea.
Right, exactly. So when I first told my parents that I was coming to Korea, well, my mom was crying and my sisters, they were crying too.
Oh, no.
I had never seen them crying so much. But that's because they were so worried about me coming here. They worry about the Korean Peninsula. We see on the news all the time in Brazil about the risks that North Korea poses to South Korea. And it's only natural that people will worry about it. Of course, when you come to Seoul and then you get used to life and you see that Korea is actually a very safe country, then eventually I could convince my parents that I really like living here, it's safe, you don't have to worry. So they changed their minds, but it's only natural they worry. North Korea is still the number one threat to South Korea. It's still their number one concern. And of course, we should always worry about them, keep our lives and live your happy lives here in Seoul, enjoy your life here in Korea, but keep an eye on them, never leave them, just do whatever they want.
And one more people, I mean, just to maybe reassure some of our viewers, more and more people are coming to Korea every year to visit for exchange programs or to live here, start a business. So maybe you can also come and visit. All right, welcome back, everyone. Let's now talk about something a bit more peaceful.
Yes.
What do you say?
Good.
A little bit of world peace here on the show. Carlos, have you ever heard of the term haenyeo?
Haenyeo. So are you talking about those ladies in Jeju Island where they go into the water without, like, no gear?
Bingo.
And they get this, they're amazing. They seem so powerful. They're
have you
so
seen
strong.
Them?
Yes. So the first time I went to Jeju, I was just walking around, and then I saw these ladies wearing those black suits, swimsuits.
Yeah, yeah.
I tried to talk to them. I didn't really talk Korean. And then Jeju Korean is so different.
Right.
So I tried to communicate with them, but eventually I saw them coming out of the water, off of all those seaweed. I was really, really impressed.
Well, guess what? We do have something to celebrate regarding these female divers. Maybe you can tell us a bit more about this?
Yes, haenyeo culture has been added to the UNESCO cultural heritage list, I believe. Mm-hmm. And this culture is an all-female culture, and because of these haenyeos, they were the breadwinners of their households, and they start to swim and dive at the age of 7, and at around 15, they're called aegi haenyeo, or baby sea women, and before they gain their regular haenyeo title. These teachings are handed down over generations. It's a person-to-person training. You can't learn it from a book or some kind of a manual. So this is why this culture has to be preserved, because these haenyeos are getting very old, and most of them are above the age of 60.
Yeah. I still like to call them the mermaids of Jeju.
Mm.
Yeah. And here at Arirang, we also have a special connection to Jeju, don't we?
Yes, Jeju is a special place, especially for Arirang Radio, I would say, because Arirang is available on the FM channel only on Jeju-do Island. And you know, the number of tourists to Jeju surpassed the 15 million mark this year.
Wow.
And I think that's why it's our duty for us working at Arirang to further promote Korean culture and tradition to the visitors to Jeju and Korea as a whole.
Yeah, and many people are interested actually in Jeju.
Yeah.
It's becoming a touristic destination. More people visiting for the food, for the landscape, for the experience.
For Arirang Radio.
For Arirang,
since you heard.
Exactly. Very on the spot. Yes.
Thank you, Carlos.
So I really hope that this haenyeo culture will be preserved for many years and decades. We have to talk about another very positive issue, I would say, in literature this time around. And maybe you've heard this before, but novelist Han Gang won the 2016 Man Booker International Prize, and she was the first Korean novelist to have won this award. So maybe, Juyeon, you can tell us a bit more about this.
Well, I'm sure that everyone probably heard of the Man Booker Prize, but just to give you a little bit of background, it's one of the three most prestigious awards given to those in literature.
Yes.
And this one is based from the United Kingdom. And the other ones are the Nobel Prize in Literature based from Sweden and the Prix Goncourt from France. But what's very special about this award is that it not only awards the original author, but it also awards the translator of the original novel. So that's how Han Gang could actually put herself out there in the global market and get recognized. It probably was a very difficult job to translate all of the details and the underlying aspects of Korean society, but apparently they did a very good job.
And the book is called The Vegetarian, is that correct?
Yes, yes. The novel was first published in 2007, and actually a movie was released in 2010 based on this novel. Mm-hmm. And this novel is really gaining renewed attention in Korea as well. And according to a local bookstore chain, 680,000 copies have been sold this year alone. As you mentioned, the translation is doing its part in the success of this novel, because translation was what made it reach out to the global audience. And that's probably why the award went to the translator as well.
So once again, I mean, congratulations to novelist Han Gang for this amazing international prize. And hopefully it will also put, you know, Korean literature on the international scene. And of course, for music lovers, K-pop, maybe for drama lovers, Korean productions. I mean, they've been pulling and pushing the Korean wave out there. So hopefully these prizes and these meaningful events will also put Korean literature in the limelight. And that will maybe also give an extra little boost to Hallyu, the Korean wave.
Hopefully.
Yeah. All right, so we've been talking about some of the hottest issues of 2016 all together here with our panelists. We've talked about politics, we've talked about the fourth industrial revolution with technologies. We also mentioned Korea's heartfelt desire for true democracy. How would you like to end this little talk show?
If I had to pick one aspect from 2016 that really struck me, it was how Koreans could find hope in the middle of such a complicated situation here in Korea in terms of politics and also economics. And once again, Koreans gave me a lesson as a Brazilian of how you should protest, of how you should fight for your rights, of how you should really strengthen democracy here in the peninsula.
To unite, work together, and look at the big picture, what really matters, right?
Right.
And new technologies like artificial intelligence and autonomous cars have truly surprised the world this year. But I guess this year was full of surprises, not just in the tech sector, but in politics or culture, across various sectors. And I believe, good or not, these changes are a significant step going forward. But one thing that we should keep in mind is that we should be prepared to really accommodate and regulate these changes in new technologies.
Exactly. We will continue to move forward together, hopefully.
And looking back from Arirang's perspective, Arirang is reaching more households and more audiences worldwide as we begin starting airing in the UK and in UN headquarters in New York.
Yeah.
So with that comes a heavier responsibility, and we'll do our best and work harder to become a better and wider window for those living abroad to look through Korea.
Yeah. And hopefully you also watching us will continue to support us and our activities. Juyeon?
Well, I think that next year will really be another turbulent year in terms of the economy and politics. Personally, I think that Korea hit rock bottom this year, but you know what they say about hitting rock bottom, the only way is to go back up. So being a true optimist, I think that we will have a better year or future ahead, and I will continue to deliver all of those juicy aspects of what happens on my show as well.
All right, well, thank you very much, I mean, for your time, for your sharp insight, and also your honest thoughts. It was a pleasure talking with you all about these issues, some of them a bit dark, but we'll try to end in a positive note. And we want to wish all our viewers, all the people around the world, all the best for 2017. The new year is coming up, so let's keep our hopes high.
Yes.
All right, everyone, lots of love and happiness. Thank you very much, and Happy New Year!
Happy New Year!